Dear students, now I am going to teach the second unit in the applied science, that is properties of solids and liquids. Properties of solids and liquids. First unit is mechanics. The second unit is properties of solids and liquids. You're all familiar. In nature, we have substances are in a different phase or a different forms. Like means the matter is basically divided into three states. Number one, solids. Number two, liquids. Number three, gases. Gases. Of course, you are familiar. The fourth state is a plasma. Plasma, but basically the matter is divided into three phases. Three phases. Number one, solids, liquids. Number three is gases. Solids. Solids. Solids have a definite shape and size. Solids have definite shape and size. Definite shape and size. And in solids, the atoms are arranged in a crystalline form. Of course, that is called a lattice. Crystalline form. Crystalline form. And the interatomic distance between the atoms, like interatomic distance between the atoms, is rich, and intermolecular distance is less. Interatomic force is greater, and interatomic distance is a poor or a less in between the atoms. And here the molecules are tightly bounded. Molecules are tightly bounded because of the greater interatomic force. Okay. So solids have definite shape and size. Shape and size. Size means a volume. And interatomic distance between the atoms or the particles is less, and interatomic force is more. That is why we can't able to break a solids easily. We can't able to break a solids very easily because of a greater interatomic force. And suppose if you want to break the solids, we have to apply force on a solids. Of course, that force is called the deforming force. Deforming force. Next, liquids. Liquids. Liquids have a definite volume. Liquids have definite volume. Definite volume. And it takes the shape of a container. Suppose if you place a liquid in a container, that liquid takes the shape of a container. For example, it is a beaker. If you pour a water in a beaker, definitely it takes a shape of a beaker. Shape of a beaker. And here the particles are loosely bounded. Particles are loosely bounded, and interatomic force is less. Interatomic force is less, and interatomic distance is greater when compared to a solid. So interatomic force is greater, and in between a particle, that is interatomic distance, is more. Next, gases. Gases, neither a shape nor a size. Neither a shape nor a size. Shape nor a size. Nor a size. Here, particles are very loosely bounded, and interatomic distance is very high, and interatomic force is also a negligible, least. Okay, so for basically, the matter is divided into three states. Number one, solids. Number two, liquids. Number three, gases. Gases. Now, let us study the in this chapter, we will study properties of solids and liquids. In the third, study the gases, heat and properties of the gases. Now, here we have a few property. Number one is elasticity. Number two is plasticity. Number two, plasticity. So solid, few solids exhibit elasticity, a few solids exhibit a plasticity. Let us define elasticity. Suppose if you have many materials, we have to apply force on a matter or a substances or a material. The material gets deformed. Deform means what? Change from the original. Change from the original. Suppose if you have one rubber band, if you apply force on a rubber band, definitely it elongates. Means its length increases. Its length increases. Increases. So elasticity, if you apply force on a solid, the body gets deformed because of the deforming force. Suppose if you release that force, if you remove that force or release that force, means deforming force, the body come into its original position. Original position. If you have a rubber band, if you apply force, definitely elongates. You release the force, it come into its original position or original shape. The property is called an elasticity. An elasticity. For example, if you have a balloon, if you pump air, is it? It gets enlarged. If you remove that, air definitely comes into its original position. That is actually called elasticity. Elasticity is a property of a body by virtue of which it regains its original shape or a size after the removal of a deforming force. Property of a material or a body, elasticity is a property of a body by virtue of which it regains its original shape after the removal of a deforming force. Deforming force. Example, rubber, even steel, is it? Steel, actually in practice steel is a more elastic than rubber. Excellent. Okay, any body which comes into its original position or original shape when the deforming force is removed, that is called an elasticity. Elasticity. Next, plasticity. Plasticity. See, opposite to elasticity is plasticity. In elasticity, we remove the deforming force, it comes into its original position. Whereas in plasticity, we apply force on a solid, solid gets or a material gets enlarged, it changes its shape. If you remove the or release a deforming force, the body will not come into its original position. Original position means plasticity is a property of a body by virtue of which it do not regains. So whereas in elasticity it regains, but in plasticity do not regains its original shape. Its original shape. Original shape. So property of a body by virtue of which it do not regain its original shape or its size after the removal of a deforming force is called a plasticity. Plasticity. Example, plastic materials. Any plastic materials. Is it? Now, so in elasticity, suppose any material that exhibits an elastic property, any material that exhibit an elastic property, they are called elastic bodies. They are called elastic bodies. Elastic bodies. Any material that exhibit a plastic property, they are called plastic bodies. Plastic bodies. But we are telling in plasticity, the body do not regain its original shape. Whereas in elasticity, the body comes into its original shape. But in practice, or in nature, no one body is perfectly plastic or perfectly elastic. Maybe, you see, for example, elasticity, if you apply force on a rubber, rubber gets elongated. If you release a rubber, you release the force, it comes into its original shape of a rubber. But maybe 99%, not exactly 100%. Like in plasticity also. See, yeah, I am telling that if the body do not regains, not 100%, maybe it regains to a few percentage also. That is why in nature, no one body is perfectly plastic or perfectly elastic. Of course, we are telling you elastic body is a plastic body, but not up to the mark of 100%. Maybe 99, not 100%. 100%. See, this is about elasticity and a plasticity. Next, stress. See, suppose the body gets regains or it changes its shape, we have to apply a force on a particular material, that is deforming force on a particular material. If you apply a force on a solid, the body gets deformed. Suppose if you apply a force on a particular area of a material, then stress will come into play. The force acting for, mean force means a deforming force acting per unit area. Deforming force acting per unit area of cross section of any deforming body. Force acting per unit area of cross section of any deforming body is called a stress. Force acting per unit area of cross section of any deforming body is called a stress. See, stress is equal to force per unit area. Stress is equal to force by area. For example, take a force symbol as F and area symbol as A and stress symbol as S, then S is equal to force by area. That is, S is equal to F by A. Here, F is the notation for a force and capital A is the notation for an area. S is the notation for a stress. Definitely, stress is equal to F divided by A. Now, what is stress? Stress means deforming force acting per unit area of cross section of any deforming body. Any deforming body is called a stress. Next, stress is equal to force by area or S is equal to F by A. What may be the unit for a stress? You're all familiar in the first chapter. What is the unit of force? What is the unit of area? So stress is equal to force unit is Newton. Stress unit is Newton and area unit is a meter square or a square meter. So unit of stress becomes Newton per a meter square. Newton per meter square. So force unit is Newton and area unit is a meter square. Therefore, stress is equal to, or SI unit of stress is equal to Newton per meter square. Now, depending upon the force applied on a body, so we can apply a force perpendicular or normal to a area of cross section of a body, or we can apply a force along the area of cross section of a body, or we can apply a force tangentially on a particular area of cross section of a body. Means depending upon the force applied on a body, we have three types of stress. We are divide stress into three types. Number one, tensile or longitudinal stress. Or a longitudinal stress. Number two, compressive stress. Number three, shear or tangential stress. See, depending upon the force applied on a body, we are divided stress into three different types. Number one, tensile stress or a longitudinal stress, volume stress or a compressive stress or a tangential stress. This stress is divided on the basis of force acting on a particular body. Now, first, tensile or a longitudinal stress. This one, tensile array, longitudinal stress. For example, if you take a rubber band, you apply force on a rubber band, definitely rubber band gets elongated, is it? Or if you take a steel wire, you take a thin steel wire, you hang a 10 kg array, a 15 kg of a load, definitely it elongates, not like a rubber band, but it elongates to a certain extent. Means we are applying a force in a particular area of cross section of the body. Here, what happening? There is a change in the length. This change in the length means the stress that tends to change in the length of a body is called tensile array, longitudinal stress. Longitudinal stress. The stress that tends to change the length of a body means you have to apply force on a solid or materials. The material gets elongated. So length should be increased. Length should be elongate means what? Length should be increased. So that's why I told, depending upon the force applied on a body, we are divided into three types. Number one is tensile. So here there is a change in the length of a body. Length of a body is called the tensile array, longitudinal stress. The stress that tends to change in the length of a body. Length of a body. Number two, volume or a compressive stress. Compressive. Volume or a compressive stress. Anybody wants to make compressive? Compress. What do you mean by compress? Compress means try to accommodate in the minimum area, least area. Compress means what? Suppose if you have a spun material, you apply a force on a spun material, definitely it gets compressed. Compress means initially it takes a more volume. If you apply a force, definitely it accommodates a least volume or a less volume. Means it gets compressed. So in that case, the body is in the least volume, a minimum one. Okay. So volume or compressive stress means the stress that tends to change in the volume. Change in the volume. So we have to apply force on a solid material in different way. So volume of material should be decreased. Change. Okay. The stress that tends to change in the volume of a body is called volume stress or a compressive stress. Number three, shear or a tangent shear. Shear or a tangent shear. Suppose if you apply force tangentially on a particular material, the shape gets changed. Shape of a material gets changed. You see, in tensile, length is changed. Number two, volume is changed. Whereas in shear stress, the shape changes. But one condition is, Without change in volume. Shape will change, not a volume. So shear or tangential stress is the stress that tends to change in the shape of a body without changing the volume. Well, majority a twisting material is, you know, suppose for example, it's a cylindrical material. Is it? See, you apply force like this in opposite direction. Is it? So it gets twisted. If it is in a material, so accordingly you apply force in different directions, definitely it gets twisted. So that the shape remains, the shape will change, but not the volume. Okay. Now, so there are three types of stress. Number one, tensile and longitudinal. The stress that tends to change in the length of a body. Number two, volume or a compressive stress. The stress that tends to change in the volume of a body. Number three, shear or a tangential stress. The stress that tends to change in the shape of a body. The condition is without changing the volume. Whatever the type of a stress, the SI unit is Newton per meter square. Whatever the type of a stress, whether it is tensile or volume or shear, the common unit is
unit is Newton per meter square. Newton per meter square. Next. Strain. The fractional change occurred in the body is called a strain. The fractional change occurred in the body is called a strain. Suppose you apply force on a solid. Because of a force, a deforming force, the body will change its shape or size, even volume. Okay. There is a change in the shape of a change in the shape of a material. In such a case, there is an internal change. Means to apply a force on a solid, there is a displacement of a molecules, displacement of a particles, and after a few, release a force, the particle come into its original shape, size, original a position. In such a case, there is a small internal change, the fractional change in a body that is called a strain. Or it is also defined as, strain is also defined as the ratio of change in dimension to the original dimension. Change in dimension to the original dimension. See, fractional change occurred in the body, we can't able to calculate easily. That's why we have a some other definition. It is also defined as the ratio of change in dimension to the original dimension. Here, common word is the dimension, means the change in the length or change in the volume. Is it original volume or original length? But generally, we are expressing with a dimension. So strain is defined as the ratio of change in dimension to the original dimension. Original dimension. For example, suppose, see, this is one steel wire. Steel wire, you say L is the length of a wire. You hang, you say 20 kg of a wire. Definitely, what happens? Definitely, it elongates. It elongates. Is it? Elongates. This is the original length L. This is what? This is change in the length. Change in the length. You say change is represented by a delta L. Delta L. See, according to this, according change in dimension is what here? A delta L. Original dimension is what? L. So suppose change in the length unit is, you say, meter. Original length is also in meters. See, meter get cancelled, then what is the unit? What is the unit? It is a unitless quantity. Unitless quantity. So, there is no unit for a strain. Because it is a ratio of common dimension. It is a ratio of common dimension. That's why the unit get cancels. So, it is a unitless. No unit. Again, the strain have three different types. Depending upon the force applied on a body, we have three different strains. Number one is a tensile, similar types, or a longitudinal. Number two, volume or a compressive strain. Number three, shear. Shear or tangential strain. Depending upon the force applied on the body, we have three types of strain: tensile or a longitudinal, volume or a compressive, shear or a tangential. Here, in first one, that is tensile or a longitudinal strain. See, tensile or longitudinal means what? Change in the length. There is a longitudinal change in the length. Therefore, strain is defined as ratio of change in length to the original length. Original length. Change in length to the original length. For example, the same way, same case. See, this is a length of the pipe. Where I am 20 kg of pipe, definitely it gets elongated. There is a change in the length delta L. See, delta L by L. Particular case, delta L by L. Delta L is a change in the length, L is the original length. Original length. Next. Volume are a compressive. Volume are a compressive. See here, the ratio of change in volume to the original volume. Change in volume to the original volume. For example, we have one material, you see, a sponge material. You apply force, definitely it gets compressed. It gets compressed. Is it? It gets compressed. Means you take change in the volume as delta V and original volume as FV. So volume of a compressive strain is defined as change in volume to the original volume, that is equal to delta V by V. Delta we use always for the change symbol. If there is a symbol delta, definitely there is a change, that too a small change in terms of increments. Next, shear or a tangential. Shear or a tangential. Here we can't able to define like a change in shape to the original shape in this case. In this case, because in a shear or a tangential stress, the shape gets changed. Shape gets changed without changing the volume. So here, let us take one example. You take one rectangle. Okay, it's one rectangle. You apply force tangentially. I mean just on the grazes of the surface. This line should be graze of the surface. Just you apply force on a surface, provided the base should be fixed. In such a case, this changes like this. Please. Now what is this figure? Initially it was rectangle. After applying a force, it changes into a parallelogram. This is rectangle. This is parallelogram. See, because of the force applied on a material or a body, there is a change in the shape. Rectangle will change into a parallelogram. Okay. Here, you now changes from here to here is there now? You say small x. This is called lateral displacement. This is called lateral displacement. Lateral displacement. And see, this upper surface, this is lower surface, this is, you say, h. This is what? A distance between the layers. Distance between layers. Of course, here there is a formation of triangle, you say, a theta, shearing angle, theta. Now, shear or tangential strain is defined as the ratio of lateral displacement between two layers to the distance between two layers. Distance between two layers. That is, lateral displacement between two layers, you say x. Distance between two layers, you can say h. It is also symbolized by a theta. X by h is equal to a theta. It is also called as a shearing angle. Now, what is strain? Strain is the fractional change occurred in the body. And it is also defined as the ratio of change in dimension to the original dimension. dimension and its unit is no unit or a unitless quantity. Again, depending on the force applied on a body, we have three different types of strains. Number one, tensile or a longitudinal. What is tensile or longitudinal strain? That is a ratio of change in length to the original length. You assume that change in length symbol is you say delta L and a original length you say L. Therefore, tensile strain is delta L by L. Delta L by L. Number two, volume or a compressive. What is compressive means? Compressive means the body try to accommodate in a minimum area, least area. Is also defined as the ratio of change in volume to the original volume. That is equal to delta V by V. Delta V is the symbol of change in volume. V is the symbol for original volume. Therefore, volume strain, the compressive strain is delta V by V. Number three, last one, shear or a tangential strain. That is the ratio of lateral displacement between two layers to the distance between two layers. In this case, because of the deforming force, body should be change its shape. Change its shape. In this particular case, the rectangle shape is changes into parallelogram. Parallelogram. And there is small displacement takes place here. Small displacement. It is called lateral displacement. But the condition is body should be fixed at a lower end at a base and we have to apply force tangentially on a surface. So because of this fixed here, no, base is fixed, so it will moves to a certain distance, you say x, that is called lateral displacement, and distance between the two layers you say h. Therefore, shear or a tangential strain is becomes x by h. Lateral displacement between two layers to the distance between two layers. So it is noted by a theta. This is about a types of strain. So far we have discussed what is elasticity, what is plasticity, stress, types of stress, strain, types of strain. Is it? Type of stress and type of strains are same. Means tensile or longitudinal, compressive or a volume, shear or a tangential. Next. Hooke's law. Hooke's is the name of scientist. Hooke's law. See, suppose you apply a force on another, definitely the stress will arise, the strain is also arise. To a certain limit. Means that is identified by scientist Hooke's. According to Hooke's, the last statement is within elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to strain. This is the statement. So within elastic limit, you see, what is elastic limit? Suppose you apply force, for example, if you take a rubber, you apply force on a rubber, see, it gets elongated to a certain extent. If you further increase the load or a force, definitely it is going to cut. Before that limit is there, no? It is called elastic limit. Up to elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to strain. That was noticed by scientist Hooke, and he made a statement. So within elastic limit, suppose if you cross elastic limit, definitely it will not show the elastic property. So within elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to strain. Suppose force acting per unit area is more, definitely strain is also more. Stress is directly proportional to strain. The condition is within elastic film. Or we can say stress is directly proportional to strain within elastic limit. This is the statement of Hooke's law. Let us see. Stress is directly proportional to strain. According to Hooke's law, a statement, stress is directly proportional to strain. Stress is equal to, you're already familiar, if you remove any proportionality symbol, we get one constant. We get one constant into strain. Constant into strain. So stress is equal to, you take one symbol or a notation for a constant, you say E. E into strain, or you cross multiply, E is equal to stress divided by strain. Now, what is E? E is a one proportionality constant, and we give a name to a proportionality constant called modulus of elasticity. What is this? Modulus of elasticity. Of course, it is a proportionality constant called modulus of elasticity. So, modulus of elasticity is what? Stress divided by strain. This is observed by using statement of Hooke's law. So within elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to strain. Stress is directly proportional to strain. So we know that if you remove any proportional symbol, we get one constant. So that stress is equal to constant into strain. Stress is equal to E into strain. E is a symbol for a constant. Symbol for a constant. And you rearrange the terms, E is equal to a stress by strain. And for E, modulus of elasticity, E, the constant of proportionality is named as modulus of elasticity. Then what is modulus of elasticity now? It is a ratio of stress to the strain. Stress to the strain. Then what is the unit for modulus of elasticity? For a stress, unit is Newton per meter square. See, already I told, stress unit is Newton per meter square. For a strain, no unit. Therefore, unit becomes Newton per meter square. SI unit of a modulus of elasticity is Newton per meter square. Newton per meter square. Now, see, this modulus of elasticity is a constant value. Constant value or a constant one. This constant value or a modulus of elasticity value is different for different materials. In nature, we have different materials, but not all the materials are uniform modulus of elasticity. See, one material have one value, some other material have other value. Means, modulus of elasticity value is different for different materials. For example, if you observe many elastic bodies, you say steel. Steel have one modulus of elastic value. You say rubber, it's a one modulus of elastic value. Or you say a cycle tube or a cycle tire, that is also elastic in nature, that have a different modulus of elasticity value. But this value depends on, see, modulus of elastic constant value depends on nature of material. Depending upon the modulus of elasticity value, the material will show a different elastic property. For example, if you take it up, it elongates more. If you take a cycle tube, a piece of a cycle tube, it will all elongate into much distance. If you take a steel wire, you have to apply more load. Therefore, just elongates into a centimeter or a millimeter, is it? That's all depends on the modulus of elasticity value. That is why the modulus of velocity is depends on nature of material. Okay, it's as it is, Newton per meter square. Newton per meter square. Now, this modulus of elasticity is three different types. Modulus of elasticity is divided into three types. Number one, Young's modulus. Y-O-U-N-G. Young's modulus. Young's modulus. Number two. Number two, bulk modulus. Number three, rigidity modulus. So, modulus of elasticity are of three types. Number one, Young's, Y-O-U-N-G apostrophe is Young's modulus. Number two, bulk modulus. Number three, rigidity modulus. Rigidity modulus. See, whatever the type of a modulus, what is the minimum for a modulus is stress divided by strain, not strain by stress, So modulus means stress divided by strain. Now let us define Young's modulus. See, the modulus means what? Stress divided by strain. Now Young's modulus is the ratio of tensile or a longitudinal stress to the tensile or a longitudinal strain. Now, actually here we have a small derivation. Derive an expression for a Young's modulus of elasticity. A small derivation. Young's modulus of any material, or simply Young's modulus of wire. You assume that, you see, it is a wire. Assume that it is a wire. What is the length of a wire? You say L meters. You apply a load. So many kg, you say M. M kg of mass. Definitely, it gets elongated. Is it? Yes. See, this is what? This is change in the length. This is, you say, L. L is the original length. Because of a force applied on this particular wire, it gets elongated. Means here, stress is also there, strain is also there. Now, what is tensile stress or a longitudinal stress? The definition of stress is force acting per unit area. Divided by tensile or a longitudinal strain means what? Ratio of change in length to the original length. Delta L by L. So that it becomes F in F by A into L by delta L. Here actually, instead of force, we are used a mass. How to change mass into a force? Just we have to multiply by a gravity. Mg. So that F becomes mass into gravity. Suppose you want to change mass into force, just you have to multiply with a g value. Say into L divided by area. For example, it is a wire. Just a cylindrical in shape. What is the area of this particular wire? See, it's a cross section like this. Is it? A circular cross section. So area becomes pi into r square. What is r? R is the radius. Into delta L. Therefore, Young's modulus, you say y is equal to mgl by pi r square delta L. Suppose if we can change radius into diameter also, what is, see, for example, this is what? A radius. Is it? Half of a diameter is radius.
That means R is equal to D divided by 2, half of a diameter. It substitutes. So Y is equal to MdL by pi into, in place of R, you substitute D by 2 whole square into delta L, so that it becomes MdL divided by pi D squared by 4 into delta L. Finally, it becomes 4 MgL by pi D squared delta L. Pi D squared delta L. The ultimate formula for a Young's modulus of a wire. 4 MgL by pi D squared delta L. M is mass, G is acceleration of gravity, that is 9.8 meters per square. L is the length of the original length of the wire. I is a constant value, 3.142 and 22.7. D is a diameter of a wire. Delta L is change in the length of a wire. Change in the length of a wire. Actually, we are getting three different formulas. It is also a Young's modulus formula. It is also a Young's modulus formula, is it? This is the ultimate Young's modulus formula. Suppose if you want to solve a problem on a Young's modulus, depending upon the data, we have to assume these three formulas. Suppose just in a given problem, say directly they give force in Newton, area in meter square, and length in meter, delta in meter, this formula itself is sufficient to solve a problem. Whereas, suppose if they change a force into mass, instead of Newtons, they may give so many kg. In such a case, we have to replace F by Mg. And area may, instead of giving so many meters square, they may give so many millimeters of radius. You say in terms of R, radius. So we have to use this formula. MgL by pi R squared delta L. Next case is, instead of radius, they may give a diameter. In such a case, we have to go for a y is equal to 4 MgL by pi D squared delta L. Depending upon the data given in a problem, we have to assume whether this one or this one or this one. So this is the Young's modulus of a wire derivation. Derive an expression for Young's modulus of wire. Young's modulus of wire. Next, number two is what? Bulk modulus. Bulk modulus symbol is saying. See, here bulk is almost a similar word for a volume. It is why the bulk modulus is also defined as the ratio of volume or compressive. Volume or compressive stress to the volume or compressive strain. So you should be very careful. It must be a stress divided by a strain. Stress by strain. So bulk modulus is the ratio of volume or a compressive stress to the volume or a compressive strain. So now here, compressive stress. Stress means what? Force by area. Volume or a compressive strain is delta V by V. That is equal to F by A into V divided by delta V. So bulk modulus K is equal to F into V, V divided by A into delta V. This much. But here there is no derivation. Simply I write according to a definition. So bulk modulus is volume or a compressive stress to the volume or a compressive strain. So stress formula is F by A, strain formula is delta V by V, that is equal to F by A into, see it's a reciprocal, therefore it becomes V by delta V. Finally tends with a bulk modulus is equal to F into V divided by A into delta V. Actually in our syllabus, there is a derivation mentioned in syllabus, derivation of
Young's modulus is mentioned, but not a bulk modulus, but bulk modulus. Okay, and here bulk modulus is defined as the ratio of volume or a compressive stress to the volume or a compressive strain. Compressive strain. So it finally its formula becomes K is equal to F into V divided by A into delta V. What is F? F is a force, V means volume, A means area of cross section, delta V means change in the volume. Change in the volume. Next one is, third one is rigidity modulus. Rigidity. R-I-G-I-D-I-T-Y. Rigidity modulus. Symbol is beta. Actually, in different textbooks, they use different symbols. So, rigidity modulus is defined as the ratio of shear or tangential. Shear or a tangential stress to the shear or tangential strain. Rigidity modulus is defined as the ratio of shear or a tangential stress to the shear or a tangential strain. Symbol, formula for a stress is force by area divided by shear or a tangential strain is x by h. X by h. That is equal to f by a into h. H by x. That is equal to f into h divided by a into x. Or in some other case, f by a divided by, they take x by h as what? Theta. Therefore, it becomes f by a into theta. F by a into theta. A into theta. Suppose in a problem, they may give a force, height, area, and lateral displacement. Height means distance between the layer. X is the lateral displacement. So we have used this formula. Theta is equal to R. Rigidity modulus is equal to F into H by A into X. Suppose if they give directly strain a theta value, in such a case we have to go for F divided by A into theta. They will give force value, area value, and directly strain. So we have to go for F by A into theta. A into theta. Rigidity modulus is defined as the ratio of shear or a tangential stress, shear or a tangential strain, and the formula becomes eta is equal to f by a divided by x by h. That is equal to f by a into x, h by, it becomes reciprocal, h by x, f into h by a into x, or eta is equal to, or a rigidity modulus is equal to f divided by a into theta, a into theta. Whatever the type of a modulus of elasticity, the SI unit is, okay, even for Young's modulus, for a bulk modulus, for a rigidity modulus, SI unit is Newton per meter square only. Whatever the type of a modulus of elasticity, the SI unit is Newton per meter square. Next, let us define the word compressibility. Are you told what is my compress? Compress means try to accommodate in the minimum area. Try to accommodate in the minimum area. Compressibility is defined as the reciprocal of bulk modulus. Reciprocal of bulk modulus. Reciprocal of bulk modulus means compressibility is equal to 1 by bulk modulus. 1 by bulk modulus. 1 by bulk modulus.
We can say 1 hour, what is bulk modulus? Volume and compressive stress to the volume and compressive strain, it becomes volume and compressive strain divided by volume and compressive stress.
Volume and compressive strain and volume and compressive stress. But basically, we define a compressibility is the reciprocal of bulk modulus. Reciprocal of bulk, that is 1 by bulk modulus. It is also defined as the ratio of volume and compressive strain to the volume and compressive stress. What may be the SI unit? See, for a compressibility, this is 1 hour bulk modulus. 1 hour bulk modulus. What is bulk modulus unit? Newton per meter square. Bulk modulus unit is Newton per meter square. That is equal to meter square by Newton. Because the reciprocal one, 1 by Newton per meter square becomes meter square by Newton. Therefore, the SI unit of compressibility is meter square by Newton. Meter square by N Newton. One more definition. Factor of safety. Actually, this word is more applicable in a civil engineering case rather than our basic science. Let it be. It is defined as the factor of safety is defined as the ratio of ultimate stress to the working stress. The ratio of ultimate is also called breaking stress. The ratio of ultimate or a breaking stress to the working stress. See, the ratio of stress and stress only. It's the ratio of a stress and stress only. The ratio of ultimate stress to the working stress or the ratio of breaking stress to the working stress. It's an ultimate stress. It's also called as a breaking stress. Its ratio becomes a factor of safety. Factor of safety actually is a constant value. Almost the factor of safety values are a constant values ranging from 5 to 10, depending upon the situations. Here, what is the SI unit? Say stress. Stress unit is Newton per meter square. Yeah. It also is stress, Newton per meter square. You see, it cancels. So, no unit. So, SI unit of factor of is no. Or a unitless quantity like strain. Strain is also unitless. The factor of safety is also unitless. One more, the last definition is Poisson's ratio. Poisson's ratio is defined as the ratio of linear strain to the lateral strain. The ratio of lateral strain to the linear strain. Anybody, what is the lateral strain? Lateral strain is actually, for example, is a rubber band. You apply a force in a rubber band. It gets elongate means there is a change in the length. At the same time, there is a change in the diameter or a thickness. Change in the thickness. Suppose if you elongate a rubber, definitely thickness of rubber will decrease. That change in the ratio of strains is actually that is are simply a change in diameter to the original diameter, change in radius to the original diameter radius, or change in thickness to the original thickness. Yes, in defined like this. Lateral strain to the linear strain. Actually, linear strain is nothing but a longitudinal or a tensile. This ratio is becomes a Poisson's ratio. Here also is a ratio of a strain and strain only. Ratio of a strain and strain only. What is strain unit? No unit. For this one also, no unit. Therefore, it is also unitless quantity. Unitless quantity. Ratio of lateral strain to the linear strain is called a Poisson's ratio. Its SI is no unit. So, unitless quantity, factor of safety, Poisson's ratio, and also the strain. These are the three quantities having unitless, unit R and no unit, no unit. These are all the definitions or concepts come under a properties of a solids. Properties of solids. So, what are all we have studied? Number one, what is plasticity? What is elasticity? Stress, different types of stress. Strain, different types of strain. Next, Hooke's law. What is the statement of a Hooke's law? Then, modulus of elasticity. What is modulus of elasticity? And what is the unit? Next, types of modulus of elasticity. That is, Young's modulus, bulk modulus, rigidity modulus, corresponding formulas. Finally, three definitions, compressibility, factor of safety and Poisson's ratio. This is about a properties of solids. In the next class, I am going to start a properties of liquids. Thank you.